Ja. Welcome everyone for this ISAM web colloquium. And on behalf of the society, I would like to thank Professor Alexander Dorn from Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics in Heidelberg for agreeing to give this talk today. And before starting the colloquium, I would like to request Dr. Ghanshyam Purohit to introduce the speaker and take the proceedings forward.
Yeah, thank you, Adit. So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Alexander Dorn. He's a scientist and a group leader at Max Planck Institute for Physics in Germany. He's also a professor at University of Heidelberg. Dr. Alexander Dorn, research theme basically is with the atomic molecular and cluster physics. He is a very active scientist and a well-known renowned scientist in the field of experimental atomic and molecular collision physics across the globe. His research interest lies with the investigation of electron and photon impact induced ionization processes by kinematically complete experiments, correlated few particle reactions. And he's also actively working in the biorelevant molecules, quantum mechanically complete experiments he's doing. And he's also studying the electron spin dependent processes. So he's heading a very active group at the Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics in Heidelberg. He has more than 150 publications in the well-reputed international journals. He also has many good awards in his name. Particularly to mention, he has received the Young Scientist Award in the name of Erhard. So Erhard is the famous pioneer to provide the first coincidence experiment in the atomic collision theories, collision experiment. Professor Dorn has been associated with me, or I can say I have been associated with him from a long time, maybe from 10 years. I have got opportunity to visit him, to work with him in Heidelberg. We also have few joint publications. So he's very nice to help the scientists coming from India to Max Planck Institute, and he has always been very helping for us. He's not a new name to the Indian society. All of the scientists working in atomic and molecular physics know him very well. So yeah, it's time to hand over the platform to Professor Alexander Dorn to begin his invited talk. So Professor Dorn, please begin your talk now. Your mic is muted, Professor Dorn.
Sorry, now do you hear me?
It's okay now, yes.
Okay, so Ghanshyam, thank you very much for this nice introduction. And I thank you for inviting me for this colloquium to the Indian Atomic Molecular Society. And I'm very happy to see many well-known faces in the audience. And well, in principle, I prepared a talk giving some general overview of what we have done in the recent 10 or 15 years, but maybe for some of you, this is well known who visited us or who know or who we collaborate with in the last years. But probably this is a good thing to do for a more general audience to give a general overview. Okay, so can you see my slides? Everything?
Yes, we can
Yes.
see.
Yes, your slides are visible. Yes.
Good. Okay, so I will start. So as was announced, my main subject of work is electron collisions and involving atoms, molecules, or clusters. And here on my slide, you can see the location of our institute on nearby to the Heidelberg city or downtown. And you see the valley of the River Rhine. And here you see the River Neckar, where Heidelberg is located. So it's a little bit outside the center or the town, but here we can have a quiet and good environment for our work in the lab or in the office also. Okay, before I start, I want to thank, well, my co-workers. So my work is placed within a department or a division of the Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics. And the head of our division is Thomas Pfeiffer, Professor Thomas Pfeiffer. So he joined us about 5 years ago and took over from Joachim Ulrich, who was our former head of the department. And my group is a smaller subgroup within this division. And at the moment on this electron collision experiment, there are a number of people who I want to thank. So PhD student from India, actually Dipti Maria Mufferil, then a German master student, Daniel Kreuzberger. I have two postdocs from China. Xuguang Ren is with me since about 10 years already, and he did most of the results, or obtained most of the results I will present today. And we had for 2.5 years, we had a postdoc by Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, and Liang Wang, he left to Kansas State University now, but he also contributed strongly to the experiments, the results I will present. Then we have collaboration with theoreticians, Yakut State University. I will show some results for molecular energy calculations and structure calculations. And we have collaboration with our German Institute of Standards, Physikalisch-Technische Bundesanstalt, where we collaborate with Wunjung Beck and Volker Dangendorf and Hans Rabus on radiation damages in biomolecules mainly. Okay, subject is electron collisions, and why are these interesting? They are studied now for many years. And of course, the reason, one of the reasons is because electron collisions are relevant in many fields and techniques, like in plasmas of the atmosphere or in technical plasmas. And here I want to pick out only one relevant point where, for example, the damage of biological tissue, if it is irradiated by high energetic radiation, is mainly due to secondary electrons, which are caused along a primary particle track. So for example, if a fast and energetic ion or a gamma ray or an X-ray penetrates a biological tissue, along the track, a lot of secondary electrons, here the orange spores or lines, are secondary electrons will be released, and these cause main damage in, for example, biological cells, and they can damage DNA and cause strand breaks. And if one considers the energy spectrum of such secondary electrons, which is plotted here for ion impact, then you see the energies are fairly low, starting at essentially zero up to 100 eV or a few 10 eV. And in this energy region, electrons are able to ionize. In the higher energy region, they are able to excite, and they are able to attach to molecules to do damages by attachment, dissociative electron attachment, and all these processes are happening in biological tissue. So one would like to understand the underlying reactions like ionization, excitation, DEA, and this is one of the motivations of our work. And here, for example, our Heidelberg Ion Radiation Treatment Center. There is a newly built treatment center for cancer tumors for patients. And this is a really a big facility where ions here in a storage ring, in a synchrotron, are accelerated to several hundred mega electron volts of energies. And then they are guided to treatment rooms. Here two treatment rooms and here a third treatment room where even the ion beam via a huge installation, a so-called gantry, can be directed from several directions onto the patient. So the patient is situated here and it doesn't realize how big the machine is he is involved in, but the beam then irradiates the tumor. And here is, in this diagram, one can see why it's so interesting to use ions for irradiation and not X-rays or gamma rays or electrons, because X-rays, if in a dependence on the penetration depths, the X-rays are absorbed mainly in the surface, so there are strong radiation damages on the skin in the first layers of the body, but ions can penetrate more deeply and they release a lot of the energy at the end of the track. And here, the main, if the properties of the radiation of the beam energy are chosen such that this peak, the so-called Bragg peak, is in the tumor, it can be efficiently destroyed and our surrounding tissue can be, well, can survive nevertheless. So this is one of the reasons why ions are used for treatment in this case. What I will present you today in my talk is a number of fundamental collisions, which we have investigated the last 10 or 15 years. And among them are the very simplest cases like helium single ionization, which is essentially a three-body problem, a basic three-body problem. Then you can go to more complicated, more complex situations like here, double ionization, emission of two electrons from helium, which is essentially a four-body reaction. So going from these fundamental systems, one can go to more relevant, like in these biological systems, relevant systems. So one would be interested, what happens to molecules, larger molecules, organic molecules, if they are bombarded with electrons? And on one side, I will show results for monomers, well, for single molecules in a gas phase, but interesting just for looking at this radiation damage in condensed matter is systems which consist of several molecules like small clusters where we attach some water molecules to these organic molecules in order to see how the environment changes the collision and the fragmentation and the reactions of the molecule. Okay, the instruments which we use is a reaction microscope, which is now used in many places, also in India in several places. It's used for looking at ionization processes involving lasers, ions, and so on. But ionization involving electron collisions is challenging for this using this apparatus because of the extraction fields which have to be applied. So in brief, this apparatus uses a gas target, so from top to bottom. There is a supersonic gas jet, so expansion of gas from a few bars of pressure through a small nozzle. And in the expansion, the gas expands, cools down, and it is collimated by skimmers. So we have a nice localized target in this spectrometer region. And then we bombard this gas jet with, in our case, an electron beam. And it must be a pulsed electron beam because it's a time of light apparatus. So the secondary particles, the ions and the electrons, they are guided by an extraction electric field, an actual electric field to an ion and an electron detector on opposite sides. And there's a superimposed magnetic field, homogeneous magnetic field, which forces the electrons to move on this cyclotron trajectories. So the trajectory is confined transversely such that a reasonable energy range is guided to the electron detector. And the unscattered projectiles, which are essentially most of the projectile, not more than one of 10,000 or 100,000 electrons will undergo a collision here. So the most of the beam has to be dumped in a bore, in a hole, in the center of the electron detector. So this is a challenge to get to properly dump and absorb, so to say, the unused primary projectiles. And scattered electrons, also scattered projectiles, they are deflected and they can, in most cases, end up on the electron detectors. So we see not only the ejected, the ionized electrons, but also the scattered projectiles. And so we have essentially all electrons emitted from such a collision we can register in the best case. The ions on the other side, they give us information on the charge state of the target and on the fragmentation degree in case of molecules. So they are really, they are important, give additional information for this condition. Okay, so in such an instrument, you can obtain the full kinetics of the fragments, so ions and electrons. And the idea is to obtain fully differential cross sections, so to completely fix the collision, the directions and energies of the fragments and the particles in the final state. So one also can get the binding energies and the ionized orbitals. So if one considers the incoming electron energy and one knows both outgoing electron energies, the difference of the sum of the outgoing energies and the incoming energies is essentially the binding energy of the ionized orbital. So the energy resolution is not tremendous. So here, for example, for argon ionization, it's between 1 and 2 electron volts, but sufficient in many cases to identify the orbital from which the electron was ionized. Okay, so this is the instrument which we use. And in this case, well, the projectile beam is aligned along the extraction fields, parallel to the extraction fields. And in this case, we make use of the magnetic field of the spectrometer also to guide the primary beam into the target and into the bore of the electron detector. And this is a reasonable challenge to realize, to not to get too many scattered electrons on surfaces and background gas. Okay, so for people who are not so familiar with ionizing collisions, with involving electrons, I give just a simple picture what one should expect for the cross section, for the emission pattern of the electrons. And normally this reaction is a rather complex free body reaction. All the particles are interacting and transferring momentum and energy within each other. But at high energies, you can treat this process as a weak perturbation of the projectile induced by the projectile into the target. So one can use a first order description for this. And in this case, one could consider ionization as a clean knockout of the bound electron. So projectile is scattered, is transferring momentum to the bound electron, and this is emitted along the momentum transfer direction. And this gives in the cross-section gives a clean binary peak, a so-called binary maximum, where the electron is emitted along the momentum transfer. And the pattern of this binary peak depends also on the bound state wave function of the momentum distribution in the bound initial state. So this gives the binary peak. And then if the ejected electron is not too fast, it can rescatter in the ionic potential as a quantum mechanical wave moving in a potential, it can rescatter and be emitted in other directions. And this gives rise essentially to the so-called recoil peak, since the ion in this case takes a large recoil momentum and is being emitted along the momentum transfer. So this is the rough structure of normal E2E, so-called E2E reaction, 1 incoming electron, 2 outgoing electrons, where we directly measure the three-dimensional momentum distribution of the ejected electrons and plot the probability as the distance of the surface from the origin to the surface is the cross-section, essentially, the magnitude of the cross-section. But in reality, at lower energies, there is a lot of more complication of this process. So there is final state interaction of the electrons. There is the projectile can elastically scatter within the nuclear potential of the ionic potential. For many electron targets, there is polarization of the whole electron cloud in the atom or the molecule. After ionization, there is a relaxation of the electrons and the orbitals. There can be different shake processes involved. And finally, the whole reaction or the whole process must be described within an totally antisymmetric wave function. So there is exchange with electrons possible. And this makes the treatment complicated for theoreticians. So just to give you a flavor, I show you some cross sections or one cross section for ionization of helium. And the incoming beam energy is 70 eV, and we fix the scattering angle, we fix the ejected electron energy, but plot the ejected electron distribution, and we see such a pattern. And you see, it roughly resembles this binary recoil peak pattern. But for example, the binary peak is shifted backwards, we switched back to the momentum transfer. And also, also this is the result from the post-collision interaction, so the two outgoing electrons repel each other. And this shifts this pattern, this observed pattern, away from the scattered projectile. And then there is a filling up of the region in between binary and recoil peak. And this for a long time was under discussion and can still not be properly described in case of ion impact ionization. But for electron impact ionization, you see this is a modern state-of-the-art theory convergent closed coupling calculation by Igor Bray in Perth, Australia. And this perfectly can reproduce this momentum or this cross-section pattern. There are other calculations like the time-dependent closed coupling theory, which come close, but there are some deviations in if you look in detail on the cross-sections. So in this case, single ionization of simple targets, they can be well described for at least with some theory approaches. But if one goes to more complex targets, like shown here, so there, this is ionization of argon. You see the emission pattern gets much more complex, and you don't get only a binary recoil peak, you get some more structure like emission pattern to the backwards direction. So incoming projectile comes from below, scattered to the left, and you see some peak going just the opposite, then some intensity in between binary recoil and an indication of a forward peak, which we cannot really see because this is a gap in our cross section due to the hole to the bore in the electron detector forward direction. So there we dump the beam, some physics is also dumped, unfortunately. So we have a hole in the acceptance to the forward direction and the backwards, strict backward direction of our spectrometer. So compared to series, you see there are different recent series and they all disagree from each other. And mostly also this experiment. And the one which comes closest to experiment is maybe this one. It shows some sort of similarities concerning some ears, which we can say, see some nose, some recoil peak, and this backwards maximum is showing here up. So, but the other theories are quite far away from what we see in experiment. Okay, so this is situation in atomic ionization. For large atoms, it gets difficult even for simple atomic systems like noble gases. And just to give you a flavor of what fundamental things we have studied in the recent years, in the recent 10 to 15 years, I give you a list without going into very detail. So I showed you ionization of helium, and neon is also a fundamental system where there are good calculations. A very interesting system would be to replace the electron pi positron by its antiparticle and just to see how the cross section are different and how the missing exchange interaction and the opposite charge of the projectile would change the cross section. So we have done a pilot study at the nuclear reactor in Munich where they have a positron source, but we got some coincidences, but in the whole beam time, only 2000 coincidences were collected because the primary beam is rather weak. So this is a still open experiment, which would be nice to perform, but we need stronger positron beam sources for such experiments. What we could realize is E2E experiments in strong laser fields where we superimposed the very intense, like 10 to the 12 watts per square centimeter laser field onto the collision. And we could observe that photons are exchanged within the laser field during the collision. So either absorbed or emitted. And this is also quite an interesting process, in particular considering the present day's experiments on ionization with strong laser fields, where there are electron collisions happening and involving absorption and emission of photons in the collision. So we, in principle, in such a dedicated E2E experiment, one could pre-select the kinematic conditions and study such processes within strong laser fields. Then an interesting question is, if one goes from a spherical symmetric target like noble gases to non-symmetric targets like hydrogen or molecules, and if one could spatially align the molecules and study how the anisotropic potential changes the cross-section as a function of the molecular and spatial alignment. And for hydrogen, such experiments are possible because in some cases, hydrogen dissociates after ionization. And then one can deduce from the emitted ion direction, one can deduce the molecular axis in space, and we could see how the cross-section is modified for different alignment angles of the molecule in space. And then if one could look for larger systems like clusters, it would be interesting to see how a single center cross-section evolves into a different cross-section if there are several scattering centers, additional scattering centers. And in case of argon clusters, we could see how more and more multiple scattering processes appear in the E2E cross-sections, how the cross-sections get more isotropic if we have ionization in clusters. And then going from two or three body systems like single ionization to one particle more, like a E3E process, where one incoming electron and three outgoing electrons are involved. For this situation, I will present some results in the next slide, so I will skip this, but this is, so to say, for theory, the next step of complexity is compared to single ionization. And then a similar process where both electrons in helium are involved, actively involved and are not ionized, but one is ionized and another one is excited. This is so-called simultaneous ionization excitation. And the excitation can be characterized by the fluorescence photon, which is emitted after the excited state decays. And this is a so-called E gamma to E experiment, where the two outgoing electrons and the emitted photon in the radioactive decay of the excited state is recorded. And it also gives information on such a collision where both helium electrons, both bound electrons, change their state. And I will pick out only one situation where we look at threshold, at the threshold region. And in principle, this is a very interesting situation because in this case, the particles are highly correlated. In case of single ionization, at threshold, for example, for hydrogen, where the threshold energy for ionization is 13.6 eV, the two electrons can escape such a situation only if they are emitted back-to-back. So only then energy can be sufficient, the kinetic energy of the outgoing electrons, to overcome this ionic potential and to minimize the mutual repulsion of the two electrons. Only in this case it's possible to escape. And this was realized quite early already by Vanier, and he considered how the cross-section evolves starting at threshold and how does the assumed such a symmetric emission configuration. And this was also extended for more bodies, for multiple ionization, for example, for double ionization at threshold. This can evolve only if there is such a symmetric configuration. If all the three electrons, they share their energy symmetrically, more or less, and they go with relative angle of 120 degree. And this was one of our motivations to find such a configuration in the threshold region. And here I see some the results which we obtained. And in one case, we started with an excess energy of 27 electron volts. So the three outgoing electrons, they can share 27 electron volts. And what we plot in this diagram is the relative angle, the mutual angles of the outgoing electrons. So mutual angle of one pair of electrons versus the angles of another pair of the three electrons. And in this case, we see small angles are forbidden just from electron repulsion. And there is a ridge of observed configurations which extend from here, from this region where there is a T-shape emission pattern. So like two electrons have back-to-back emission and the two other pairs have a 90 degree angular separation. This is can be varied to this symmetric configuration with 100, 120 degree, 120 degree. And so it's still a large range of configurations possible. But going from here to lower energies, this situation changes. So the lowest energy we could go in this case is 5 eV above threshold, where the three electrons share 5 electron volts. And then this T-shape pattern, this dies out, it disappears. And finally, only this symmetric emission pattern is surviving and observed in such a measurement. And if one looks at the angles, the possible angles, one sees a clear maximum at 120 degrees, which corresponds to this symmetric emission pattern. The problem is, of course, the cross-section goes down tremendously. And to collect this data, it took several months of continuous data accumulation time to get the few thousand of events for this low energies above threshold. Now there's a question which remains, because if we have this symmetric emission pattern, the sum momentum of the electrons is essentially zero. So the question is, where is the momentum of the incoming projectile? Yeah, so the incoming projectile at this incoming energy has 2.5 atomic units of momentum. And the outgoing electrons essentially sum up to zero momentum. This is seen here in this diagram where I plot the longitudinal momentum versus the transversal momentum for the electron sum momentum. This is essentially centered at zero. There's no momentum carried by the electrons. And then the only choice is that the outgoing doubly charged ion has to carry the incoming projectile momentum. And this is indeed the case. So this is the measured ion momenta, and it has essentially the 2.5 atomic units of the incoming projectile momentum it carries. So you see there must be some quite delicate dynamics in this collision, such that all the momentum is given to the ion and the three electrons, they are symmetrically emitted in such a symmetric configuration. Okay, so for this part of the fully differential cross sections for single and double ionization, I give a short summary that for the simple targets, this is a well understood process, like hydrogen, atomic hydrogen, or helium. This can be treated accurately, but larger atoms and molecules still pose severe challenges for theory, as you have seen. I showed you results for this threshold regime, so the one-way regime, and this is dominated by electron repulsion. And at 5 eV, we have excess energy, we have very symmetric emission pattern. And interestingly, there are recent calculations like by James Colgan 7 years ago. He predicts that this situation of the symmetric emission is different if you look at different targets, like for lithium. There are double ionization of lithium, where the electrons must come from different shells, from the inner shell and the valence shell. And in this case, there can be a time sequence, successive collisions involving inner shell and outer shell. And in his calculation, he concludes that there must be a T-shape emission pattern, even very close to threshold. And at the moment, we are working on experiments on these systems to see if this is indeed the case, because Vanier didn't consider the structure of the atom in concluded that all the atoms, it's irrelevant of the structure of the target, the symmetric emission pattern. And these calculations are in contradiction to this. Okay, now I come to molecules, to molecular reactions, which we studied. And I mainly concentrate on this molecule, which is tetrahydrofuran. It's a five-membered ring of four carbon atoms, one oxygen. It could be a model system for the sugar, for the deoxyribose in the DNA, in the human or in the biological DNA chain, where it links the bases to the backbone of the DNA. So it's very similar to that, and this is one reason why we have chosen it. And the question is, how does it react, or how does it break up in collisions with electrons? And what happens in collisions? And here I show you the fragmentation pattern which we observe. So our spectrometer cannot only be used for momentum analysis of the ions, but in principle it's a time of light spectrometer, mass spectrometer, which can in this case resolve single mass units of hydrogen loss channels. So here is the intact ion, and in the next to it is the ion where one hydrogen atom was lost, and then the ring break channels where we see only fragments of the molecule. And this is in principle interesting in itself, but what would be more important is to know which energy we have deposited into the system, which orbital was ionized for the individual channels, break up channels. And this is possible with this technique, experimental technique. So for each fragmentation channel here in the lower diagram, the binding energy of the ionized orbital is obtained. So the binding energy is plotted here. For the highest occupied orbital, roughly 10 eV are necessary to ionize it. And in this case, the ion is intact. It stays intact, doesn't break up. And if there is the next inner molecular orbital ionized, the internal energy is sufficient for emission of a hydrogen. So then the hydrogen emission channel is open. And for the ring breaking channels, we need more internal energy in the molecule. We must ionize more strongly bound orbitals, and therefore the energy goes up in this case. For example, here we have a chain of three carbon atoms with six hydrogen atoms, and there is an additional hydrogen loss in the next peak and additional hydrogen loss. So more and more hydrogens are emitted, and this requires more and more energy. And therefore, the binding energy is increasing for this chain of fragmentation channels. So what we learned from this is that this is a typical fragmentation which can be considered as a statistical a statistical decay of the ion, where a certain orbital is ionized, but this electronic excitation energy is quickly transmitted or transferred into vibrational energy by internal conversion. So the state, the molecular ion quickly moves down on crossing or intersecting energy, potential energy surfaces to the molecular or electronic ground state. And the excitation energy is quickly transferred into vibrational energy. And then emission pattern, binding barriers can be overcome in a statistical process if all the vibrational energy gathers in a certain vibrational mode, the molecule can break up. So this is a typical statistical decay, which we have observed here. And now the question is, what happens if this molecule is not isolated, but if it is embedded in an environment like it is in a natural environment, in a biological cell? So there are water molecules surrounding the molecule. And then according to the reaction mechanism, which I just described, that we have vibrations which give rise to the breakup, one could conclude that such vibrations are efficiently cooled if there is an environment. And this is indeed the case. So if one looks at ionization of such molecules in, in hydrated clusters, in clusters where we in compass or embed the molecule in water, water molecules can be evaporated and the internal vibration of the molecules can cool down and the fragmentation can be suppressed, so to say. Yeah, and this is a process which most likely will evolve in nature, in the cells, and prevent fragmentation. And there are other processes which must be faster, like compared to this evaporation and this cooling, this environmental cooling, which then are more important in fragmentation and damaging. And I will show you one process which we have found in clusters and dimers of one water and one tetrahydrofuran molecule. And this is the so-called intermolecular Coulombic decay, ICD. And this process, this is known since about more than 20 years. It was theoretically predicted by Lenz Sederbaum, a theoretician here in Heidelberg, at the Heidelberg University. And he predicted well from clusters of dimers of noble gases, such a process where in the first ionization process, the inner valence hole is produced in one of the molecules, in one of the atoms. Here I have the example of a dimer of water molecules, two water molecules which are bound with a hydrogen bond to each other. And here there is an inner valence hole, essentially the oxygen 2s orbital, or in the water, the 2a1 orbital. If this is ionized, then, Auger decay is not energetically possible, but a single molecule would decay by fluorescence decay, but the energy is possible, the energy is sufficient to ionize the neighboring molecule, so the neighboring water molecule, and by a dipole-dipole interaction, the energy can be transferred and ionize the neighbor molecule. And then in the final state, we have two ions and the Coulomb explosion, and the two ions will be emitted back to back, and we see two ions in the experiment. So this process was found or confirmed experimentally around 2004 for noble gas dimers, and it was found for such a water dimer in 2010 by two independent groups, and they considered this to be important source for low energy electrons in biological tissue, because except in addition to the primary ionized electron, there is a second electron and second low energy electron emitted in such a process. And this further could emit, could also do damages in biological environment. So I show you what energetic conditions are required for such intermolecular Coulomb decay. So here the singly ionized states are plotted. So the outer valence ionized energies, which are below 20 eV, then there are the inner valence energies and the more strongly bound ionized states. And if the ionized states have energies above the double ionization potential of a molecule, like it is in this case, it's the case here, then Auger decay is possible. And Auger decay is much faster than the other processes, like fluorescence decay or ICD. So this will happen in case of high energies of the bound of the ionic states. But if there is an energy region like below Auger decay region, and where ICD can happen, and the energy of the single ionized states must be above the two center ionized states. So if the two charges in the final state are shared between the two centers, then these state energies are lower, because the electrostatic repulsion of the two charges is lower compared to the one center states, and then these inner valence states can be energetically in a region where ICD is possible. So this is, so to say, a certain energy region where ICD is possible and much faster than like fluorescence decay or internal conversion. So here I studied, or I discussed this system where we want to see if also biological or organic molecules can be involved in such a reaction. And we have calculations from our theoretical colleagues in Kutz. And they obtained these energies of single ionized states, for example, here the carbon invalence states, which are not sufficient to produce doubly charged states for this dimer. So in this region, in this diagram, the doubly ionized states are plotted. And here in orange, the shared ionization states where PHF and water each have one charge state. And the lowest one is here at 25 eV. So here, the singly charged state of the two oxygen 2S vacancy is sufficient in this case to cause such, to reach such a final state. And this is why it could potentially be possible to observe such ICD processes. So here I will present a chain of observations which we have performed to identify this ICD. So on one case, what one should observe, in the first case, one should observe a Coulomb explosion, so an ion-ion coincidence in the final state. And then I want to discuss the kinetic energy release in such a process, if it is reasonable what we see. And then the initial state which was ionized in the initial collision should be identified, in particular for electron impact, since the same final state in principle can be reached if the projectile ionizes the both molecules in a sequence, in a sequential collision first with water and then with THF. In principle, the same final state can be reached. But for this invalence shell, we have a characteristic energy which we want to see. Then we want to see the energy spectrum of this ICD electron. And then finally, we can estimate the cross-section of the sequential process. And as I will show, it is smaller than this invalence ionization cross-section. So first, the ion-ion coincidence. And in this diagram, I plot the first ion time of light versus the second ion time of light in case we observe two ions from the same projectile pulse, so to say. And this pattern, this diagonal pattern is a clear coincidence pattern where the two ion momentums, or in this case, the ion time of light is correlated. And here for the light ion, we have the water time of light along this line. And along this line, we have the tetrahydrofuran time of light. And this means that if both ions are strongly correlated, and there is a momentum correlation, which is shown here as an example for THF plus and hot water plus, that both momenta are strongly correlated. So if water is emitted along the positive X direction, if water is emitted along the positive X direction, then the THF is emitted with the same momentum in the opposite, in the negative X direction. So this confirms that we see these coincidences, these Coulomb explosion events. And in addition to these intact molecules, we see hydrogen loss, which is even more intense than the intact molecule in this case. So considering the kinetic energy release, what we observe for both coincidence channels, the intact molecule and the hydrogen loss channel is presented here. So some peak around 2.5 eV with a certain range of kinetic energy releases. And the blue curve is a simulation which we performed, since the kinetic energy release for molecules, it's not just the initial distance of the initial bond separation of the two molecules. And but it's also the case that a certain amount of kinetic energy release can be transferred into internal vibration and rotation of the molecules. Therefore, it's not a simple case to deduce this kinetic energy release. And therefore, we have performed simulations of this Coulomb explosion, where we start from a stable neutral state and remove two charges, and then simulate how the molecules separate and how much energy goes into vibration and rotation and how much energy goes into center of mass energy. this we could follow as a function of time. And the total energy is plotted as a red and a black curve for certain initial temperatures, so temperature zero and 10 Kelvin temperature of that molecule, which should resemble our jet temperatures. And then the dashed curves are the center of mass energies. And we can, we can conclude that the energies should be in the region of 3.1 or 3.2 electron volts. And this is essentially for many simulations, it's the blue curve. So the order of magnitude, the magnitude is correct, but still the width is not yet fully understood. And so there are some simplifications in this calculation. So we do not know the lifetime of the inner valence excited ionized state. So how long does it take for ICT to proceed? And there are some unknowns in these calculations, which we hope can explain this. So it's not fully explained, this kinetic energy release. Then what next I study is the energy spectrum of the emitted electrons. So we want to conclude on the binding energy of the ionized state. And this, since we have in this case only detected one electron, we have to use the whole electron spectrum. And this is a typical electron spectrum for ionization. So we see if we have a high incoming energy, we see energy loss pattern. So the highest energies of the electron spectrum is a step function. And then we see such a curve of the electron spectrum, and the lowest energies are most likely ionized electrons. So this is, for example, for ionization of water, we see fast scattered projectiles and so emitted electrons. Strictly speaking, we cannot do this assignment since both electrons are indistinguishable, but it's very likely that this is the scattered projectile and this is the ionized electron. And from this spectrum, we can see the minimum energy loss required for this process, which we study, and we can see the ejected electrons also. So here is the energy loss spectrum, and I plotted increasing energy loss from starting from zero to higher energy losses. And just for the monomer ionization of tetrahydrofuran and water, I see these step functions for the threshold, for the minimum energy loss required for ionization. And then for such a sequential process, one expects that we have to convolute both curves and add the Kuhnau repulsion energy. We should expect such a energy loss function if the sequential ionization process takes place. And for the inner shell ionization of water, the oxygen 2S, we expect the energy loss in the region of this blue bar. And what we see also for water inner shell valence or inner valence ionization, we see this blue curve. So we could measure this for water vapor, for monomers of water. And for the coincidences of our 2-1, for the Kuhnau explosion, we see exactly the same energy loss curve. So this makes us confident that we do not have the sequential process, but clearly much better agreement with this inner valence ionization. And then secondly, we study the low energy electron spectrum. So we want to identify this ICD electron and the spectrum of it. And so we have an electron spectrum of pure water, which is the red line. And we compare the electron spectra we get for our coincidences, for our Kuhnau explosion. At high energies, we see the same. And at low energies, there's a difference due to this low energy electrons, these ICD electrons, and the difference is like this. So we can get an idea of the spectrum of the ICD electrons. And finally, the sequential collision. So we can estimate the sequential collision cross section from known cross sections, for published cross section. And it should be a roughly 20% of the inner valence cross section for this oxygen 2S ionization. So in summary for this ICD process, then we can say in principle, we have shown that this ICD is happening in this dimer of a water molecule with this organic THF molecule. And for biological systems, such a process is potentially strongly damaging, since in a single collision, we produce two energetic ions. So we produce two ions which have some kinetic energy and are receding from each other, and three slow and reactive electrons. So it can be quite a dense ionization center, which can be fairly damaging or dangerous for complex biological molecules. In the next steps, our goal is to demonstrate this process not only for such dimers involving water, but for pure organic molecules, complexes of pure organic molecules. So in carbon, the 2s vacancy could be energetically sufficient to induce ICD also in pure organic complexes. And this would be an interesting process to show. In principle, we have done this for benzene, as an example, benzene, but I think time is running out, and I just show you a coincidence line where we have found coincidences between two intact benzene ions from a dimer ionization process, and back-to-back emission is seen. So it is an indication that we see this process also in poor organic clusters and dimers. So finally, I summarize my talk. So what I have shown you is that the simplest ionizing collisions, very simple fundamental few body reactions, are fairly well understood. But for complex atoms, molecules, or clusters, these are highly challenging for theory. And we found identified reactions you could confirm in condensed systems, like this ICD reaction, which is potentially a very relevant reaction in biological system. And it has not been considered in, track simulations, where radiation tracks of energetic ionizing particles are simulated in biological tissue. This is not a process which is included in such simulations, and probably it has some impact and some influence on these radiation tracks. And this is this. I still remind you that most of the work is mainly Shukang Ren and Liang Wang, and I thank you for your attention.
I request to audience members, you can post your question in the chat box or your name, and we can take it one by one.
Can I ask you one question, Alexander?
Yes, sure. Lukesh.
Hi. Okay, this ICD, the way you estimated the ICD, there are a lot of variations. Is it statistically meaningful?
Pardon? What is the question now?
See, you derive the ICD spectrum by subtracting two spectrum, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, but statistically, how they are they very meaningful? Because they are showing many peaks.
Yes, this is statistically not meaningful. This is clearly not meaningful. So our statistics of these coincidences is not sufficient for really identifying peaks.
Okay.
We have electrons in a certain energy range, and this is what we can conclude. So above a certain energy range, we both spectra for water inner valence shell ionization and the process which we observe are identical, but below a certain energy, there's an additional contribution which we assign to these ICD electrons. This is at the moment the only thing which we conclude.
But this matches the predicted energy.
Yes. So the predictions you can obtain from the state energies, so the difference of the initial ICD state and the final states which can be reached. So this can be concluded from essentially here from this spectrum, from the binding energies. So if we assume this inner oxygen 2s vacancy, this is the lowest one of this, is responsible, then this is at the energy of 30 electron volts, and the lowest final state is like 5.5. So we should obtain a transition energy of 4.5 or 5 electron volts. So we should, mainly considering this, we should get electron energies up to 5 electron volts. And what we see is more or less, okay, it's much more. It's not more or less good, it's much more. So, good question. So, we see that maybe we have to include other states. Of course, there are higher, more strongly bound initial states. The question is, what is their fates and what is their transition probability to which final states? But energetically, of course, one can find states which satisfy what we observe.
Okay. But thank you.
It's only considered energy wise, and no transition probabilities or rates are considered in the theory.
Okay, thank you.
Professor S.K. Kumar has a question. Can you comment a little more on the structure in energy spectrum of the molecule, the dimer? THF and H2O dimer. Yes.
The energy spectrum, probably this is the same question of as Lokesh has posed.
Similar
question. So this is essentially now a detailed discussion or consideration of the states which can be excited in the initial state and the states which can be reached in the final state. And so this would be nice to have theories or calculations which give us the transition probabilities to the different final states of this shared charge states. And this could give then the energy spectrum, expected energy spectrum. And maybe I can show you, if I find it, for benzene. Maybe I can see it for benzene. For benzene, there is a calculation which gives more details. Like an energy spectrum. Maybe I can find it. Here it is. So in principle for benzene, it's the same way. We have inner valence shell ionization. And if we do it for monomer, we get the red spectrum. And if we see coincidences between two intact benzene ions, we get this experimental dots, these open circles, and the difference is the energy spectrum of the ICD electrons. And you see that maybe the error bars are smaller. And so this is what we get out of this case for the benzene case. And here maybe the structure is more meaningful than what we had for this other case. And so this is the energy spectrum. And here we can compare with calculations from Nicolas Surat, who did the energy calculator energies, and he gave a tentative energy spectrum for the ICD electrons. So we see a peak here, at least this is what we can confirm in experiment also. And there is a theoretical peak here, maybe we don't see it in the proper position. So we are coming to a situation where we can interpret the spectrum in more detail, but it's still large error bars, and this is the problem of this measurement.
Shiva, wait.
Yes. Hi, Alexander. I have maybe a related question in that sense. Thanks for the showing us the beautiful results from both THF water and also with benzene. This is also regarding maybe the way you interpret the spectrum theory. Does the initial configuration of the neutral cluster with water, especially the intermolecular distances that one considers, are the calculations like quite sensitive on that? And how do they sort of initialize the system? Would you know this? I was just interested in knowing more about this.
Yes. So, in principle, what is done, for example, for the simulations which we have performed, like here, so where we start with an initial neutral state and of the dimer, so a water molecule which is hydrogen bonded. There's a hydrogen bond between the negatively charged oxygen in the THF and the proton. So the proton is aligned along this bond direction, so proton donor, so to say. So this initial state was calculated with the Gaussian program, with this commercially available quantum chemistry software to really calculate structures of ground state molecules and also of these small clusters or small dimers. So this is the neutral initial state which we obtained from this consideration or calculation, and then we put two charges. Yeah, then this is the initial state where we start with, but we charge the system and we start from this initial spatial and molecular arrangement, and then we let the system evolve. But also what En Liang also did, he put in some energy, some thermal energy, so he had the contact of this dimer with a thermal bath, and he allowed it to thermalize for a certain time before he started the simulation. So this is the calculation of the temperature of 10 Kelvin for the initial neutral dimer. He had a sudden charging of the system, and he simulated the evolution, the time evolution then of the molecules or the molecular explosion. So this is at the moment what he did in this simulation.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you. That's nice.
Jump back, please.
Alex, thank you for a very, very nice talk and very informative also. So there are also a few PhD students attending this seminar here. So I would like to have your suggestions, which kind of work on the molecules will be beneficial in maybe a few coming years, maybe 5-10 years, which may be a potential to study. Which kind of molecules they can consider for the electron or positron impact ionization studies, and which kind of study should be performed. So that also has some experimental meanings along with the theoretical work.
Yeah. Okay, so you ask for the fully differential cross section. So this
fully differential cross section. Yes, correct.
For molecules and more larger systems like...
Correct.
Yeah, so the problem here is that theoretical results are quite far from experiment.
Till now complex, it has been, It's
quite a complex problem.
Yeah.
And so we have done, because I showed you results for this THF, but I didn't show you this fully differential cross-sections for this molecule. So
yeah.
We done this and we have results for these molecules. We have also results from different theoretical calculations, and it will be in a short time there will be a publication of those results. But it turns out that these molecules, in order to describe them, it's really challenging for the theory. And problem is that it's a multi-center potential, where the incoming and all the continuum particles, they move in this multi-center potential. So how this to include this in its full complexity in the calculation is hard. And then experimentally, we are not able to have a certain spatial alignment or orientation of the molecule. So we average over many orientations, all orientations of the molecule. This is not nice for theoreticians because they have to do a lot of calculations for each, strictly for each molecular orientation in space, they have to do a separate calculation.
Yeah.
So this is not nice.
Yeah, that's true.
Averages, it washes out also some structure of the cross section. So the cross sections get not so structured anymore. So we see for this molecule, for this THF, we see a more isotropic emission pattern. It's not complete. Mm-hmm. You can see a binary in recoil peak. You can see this pattern, but in addition, there's not so much structure. Yeah, it's a little disappointing how it looks like. So one has to identify cases where one really can learn something new from this and where you can have a handle that it becomes close to the experimental result. Yeah. So for example, for this THF molecule, also there are some different conformations. So this molecule can also exist in different ways of how the relative bond angles are. This is not really only a unique situations, but different configurations and symmetries can contribute. And these, for example, have different results even in the cross section. So this is the thing. So if one can resolve these differences, if one can conclude which spatial structure the molecule has from the E to E cross section, this is one interesting case one can make. So one has to identify something interesting in these cross sections and these collisions, which allows to make conclusions. So in general, the theories are very hard to perform.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for example, your theory would be suited maybe for the higher energies, for the more energetic collisions. Maybe in this region one can find situations where you can get good agreement with our results. But we have to pair and we have to find situations which work.
Okay, yeah. Thank you for the important comments. Yeah. Okay.
So, I don't see any more questions at the moment.
Aditya, may I ask a follow-up question?
Sure.
Hi, Alexander. Also motivated by what you were just explaining about the structure of the initial configuration, is it possible, you think, to deduce from the momenta of the ions some information about the initial structure, especially when we consider an ICD process, which is quite fast?
Yes, of course. this is the underlying principle, well, probably of the difference of this, what we observe in this kinetic energy release spectrum. This is a significant difference of what we observe and what we simulate. Yeah, so as I said, the magnitude is somehow reasonable what we simulate, but the width of this distribution is probably showing that our initial state is not the good one or the correct one which we assumed to have. Yeah, so maybe these two molecules they roam, there's a roaming around each other, and the mutual distances can vary much stronger than what we have in our assumed initial state, or our temperatures of the target or the dimers are much higher than what we assumed in this calculation. So this Kerr spectrum, I think it allows to conclude what is the initial state, but there are some things which make it a little bit more difficult, since we do not know exactly the lifetime of this ionized intermediate state. State which then will subsequently decay in a Coulomb explosion. So if this lifetime is long, maybe there can be additional dynamics in this intermediate state, in this singly charged state. But if we neglect its lifetime, then we can learn about this initial neutral state.
Thank you.
So, if there are no more questions, then let me thank Professor Don once again on behalf of all the audience members as well as the society for accepting the invitation and agreeing to give this talk. Thank you. And also thanks to the audience members for joining us today. The next colloquium of the society is scheduled in first week of November, and our speaker is Professor Lokesh Trivedi from Tata Institute in Mumbai. So I'll send you the details maybe next week and hope you all can join us there. So thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you also for joining and for listening to this talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alexander.
Goodbye. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Alexander.
Bye, Alex.
Bye.
Thank you, Alex.